From the RSNA, I'm Dr. Linda Chu, and welcome to the Radiology Journal podcast. In the January issue of Radiology, Dr. Hedwig Vrisak and Dr. James Brink co-authored an editorial entitled Radiology 2040, in which they discuss how the field of radiology will continue to evolve. We did a two-part interview with the authors since this is such an interesting and thought-provoking topic. This week, we'll hear Dr. Vrisak's interview.
Welcome to the Radiology Journal podcast. I'm your co-host, Dr. Refki Nicola. And today on the podcast, we are speaking to Dr. Rikak, who's chair of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York, regarding her recent article with Dr. James Brink entitled Radiology 2040. Welcome to the podcast. It's nice to have you on the podcast.
Thank you very much.
I wanted to talk to you about your recent article in the upcoming edition of Radiology entitled Radiology 2040. You mentioned earlier in the beginning of your article, how have radiologists today been victims of their own success? Can you explain that further?
Yeah, of course. So I think that I'm sure you're experiencing as well. The demand for imaging, and since I am in a cancer center, especially in oncology, keeps increasing. We now face larger and larger volumes of examination. Furthermore, there is exponential increase in the number of images that are generated by either CT, MRI, or PET-CT. And another thing that is really prevalent across the country is the demand for 24/7 coverage. So it's not surprising that radiologists are among the highest specialty with the burnout and severe burnout. And what's interesting that we worked so hard to convince our colleague surgeons, medical oncologists, and so on, how important imaging is. And in a cancer care today, the diagnosis is made by imaging. All of the solid cancers require biopsy, which is done by interventional radiologists. They don't start treatment without imaging. So we worked very hard to convince how essential imaging is in continuum of care. And now we find ourselves barely coping with the ability to deliver on the demand. Yeah, what would you say?
You know, I think I agree with you. I think we have created a technology that really have not been able to keep up with, and we need to find solutions and alternative regarding this issue.
Yes, absolutely, yes.
I wanted to highlight some of the topics that you talked about in the article, and one of them is radiology workflow and teleradiology. How can we direct our workflow based upon disease's focus rather than patient location?
There are different practices in radiology. In a general practice, it will be patient focus. It's a first triage. In a subspecialty centers, being HSS, such as a hospital for special surgery, cancer centers, in any infection disease, in a subspecialty center, you have to, through the work list, and we're already doing that in many hospitals, it simply, through the work list, it goes to the person that is subspecialized. For example, in all the chest films from the thoracic surgery or medical oncology go to the thoracic radiologist. GU goes to the GU subspecialty, GI. We simply have to match our clinical knowledge to that of our referring physicians so we can be equal partners at the tumor boards, equal partners at the table when we discuss clinical problems. I know it is easier said than done. It is difficult in a smaller hospitals. I fully understand that. But it will slowly happen at all levels.
I guess that would be assuming that you have enough people to provide services for all those different areas, correct?
Absolutely. You are absolutely right. And that's why I am careful when I say something that like this that I believe. You know, if you have 10 GU radiologists, of course, there is no problem doing the GGYN, but the smaller hospitals don't have that luxury. But through the workflow and with the help of AI, I think it will slowly change.
You mentioned about maintaining the balance between home reading station and providing a strong presence within a healthcare institution. How could we do that as radiologists?
I fully understand. I mean, COVID has brought many, many changes to our lives. And one of them is really the workflow. And it's we suddenly realize that actually we can read from home and the workflow is fine and the clinical services are being covered. But that was at the time of crisis. And now we need to balance the home reading versus strong presence in the hospital. And we have to be flexible. We have to understand everybody's needs. But if we don't remain very strong presence in the hospital, we are at disadvantage in the long run. I know some people go as far as saying, if you continue to read from home, you'll become a commodity. I think I wouldn't be that harsh, but there is a great danger that we will not remain as players, significant players in clinical care. So that's up to chairs to find that balance. There are different ways of doing this, but we have to find the balance. And not everybody can read from home, and especially not read from home all the time. There is another element when you read from home all the time, and that's consultation, talking to your radiologist next door, looking at the films together, working with residents and fellows. So there are many, many other than presence in the hospital, essential points that we have to remain, have a critical mass in the hospital, and then organize how work from home and who should and for how many days a week they should work. It's a delicate issue. And you know what? It's also evolving. We went from all the time at home to being happy being back to realize we want half and half. So we just have to monitor what's happening.
So do you think that the future will be a hybrid model for most institutions?
A reading from home is not going away. It will be a hybrid, but then you do have radiologists that actually want to be on site most of the time or all the time. They are usually very academically driven, research driven. And so you're going to ask people, what would you like to do? Because you always we have to meet in the middle. We have to know what you want and then design so it's good for both radiologist and the hospital.
How can radiologists stay relevant in the fast-paced world of AI?
AI is already here. It's here to stay. It's evolving, just like you say, extremely fast. But it is not affecting only radiology. It's affecting every segment of healthcare. It's affecting pathology as much as it's affecting us. I actually really would encourage all of us to embrace AI. One, it's going to help us, and it's already helping us in the workflow, both on the front and the back end. As far as we are looking at the images, we spend so much time measuring cancer, measuring lesions, comparing with the old scans. If all of that can be facilitated by AI, then we can really look at the study and give meaningful, clinically relevant impression. We can have a discussion that will really be clinically relevant, and we will not be tired of measuring multiple lesions. So that's just one example of AI. I think we really need to embrace, it's not going to replace a radiologist. It's just going to change the way we work. In a way, it will help us because we will be less tired at the end of the day sitting in front of CT and doing multiple measurements and comparison. So I think we should all embrace AI, work with AI, and you know, many years ago, when CT started, not every radiologist embraced CT. When MRI started, not every radiologist embraced MRI. Those that embraced, and your generation was brought up with CT and MRI, you benefited because we see so much more. We are so much more precise in our diagnosis. I don't think we can today imagine the world without CT or MRI. But at one point, it was a big change. And that's now how AI is a big change. People at the birth of CT were saying, radiology is over, surgeons are going to take over because it is so easy to read CT scans and you see everything. Not true. We remain stronger than ever. And if anything, just like we started this discussion, we are the victims of our own success. So we have to look at AI in a very similar way.
Knowing that AI is here to stay, how can we integrate it into radiology residency program? What are your thoughts?
That is an outstanding question. We are and have been a little slow in redesigning our residency and fellowship curriculum. And now, and very often, we have been reactive rather than actively, progressively make a change when just before the time, it's make the change on time. So I think that it's time to start redesigning radiology residency. You ask me if I think that AI will be its own fellowship. For those few, we have fellowship in informatics, for example. So for those few that are really interested, we should offer such fellowship because we have really, I'm sure, so many departments have outstanding faculty that are really, really knowledgeable and proficient in AI. Maybe it can be together with informatics. But even more important question is how to introduce AI as a part of the curriculum. For not that you need to learn now how to model, but you need to understand the basics. And then even a bigger question, once the AI is used in our routine work, how are we going to train and design to train residents? We, both you and I, we learn radiology by recognizing what's normal and what's abnormal. If now AI feeds you those results, you may not even look at all the normals. So there has to be discipline. How to train our residents normal from abnormal and then do an added value of AI. It is not easy. It is much easier said than done. But I think now is the time to start thinking how to redesign the curriculum for our residents.
It's an interesting idea, and I'm wondering how that will progress and how that will happen.
Well, we have to trust, right? Those are our program directors, ABR, they're outstanding. And I'm sure probably as we are talking, they're already thinking about it and have a first draft, but it will happen. It has to happen.
You talked about value-based care. What do you think the simplest and most direct way radiologists can provide value-based care?
When we talk about value-based radiology or value-based care, I know there are fancy definitions, there are articles written, but actually value-based care means that we as radiologists bring value to patient management. And that starts from helping with the most appropriate exam. Have our exams done in a timely fashion. There are a number of places today that demand has far outpaced their ability to accommodate. And patient can wait 3-5 days for the breast biopsy. That's wrong. So we need to design our workflow where we're going to have a timely, accurate performance of the exam, precise reporting, and the information as we report has to be clinically relevant. And that clinical relevance drives towards subspecialization for maximal value created. But I mean, if you read MRI exam of the pelvis, and they want to rule out they're looking at the ovarian mass, a report that says ovarian mass is present, it can be benign or malignant, is not clinically valuable. So that where that additional knowledge of subspecialization or just additional knowledge come in, and that is value-based care in a short and simplified version. We have to really place ourselves and integrate ourselves in the care continuum, attending tumor boards, attending multidisciplinary conference. We have to be heard. There has to be a presence. And we can do it. Believe me, we can. We changed so much, even in the last 40 years, not to go further. You know, we used to be shy, often radiology in the basement with the closed doors. That's not the case. And give you another example how we change. When PACS started, in many institutions, at that time I was at UCSF, we were revolting against PACS. We liked the films. We liked the feeling of the film. I mean, there were discussions, why do we need PACS? Today, we embrace PACS. Nobody, digital imaging is a norm. You wouldn't want reading from the films anymore. So every change at every time is anxiety provoking. There are many that are going to say, no way, I cannot do this. I will not do this. But at the end, we do. We are happy and we realize how actually helpful it has, all those advances, how helpful they have been. So I guess you can say I'm an optimist, but I really think, you know, people unfortunately sometimes ask, will radiology as a specialty be present 40 years from now or 20 years from now? You shouldn't even ask that. You should ask, how are we going to be even stronger? How can we do that? And just change. Close your eyes, embrace change, and move forward.
I want to talk a little bit about, you touched on it, the evolution of imaging technology. Which modality do you think is most poised to demonstrate the fastest evolution?
we already see that for a number of things, you really need a multimodality approach. So there will be a big changes in the modalities. Don't get me wrong, especially MRI. We are now really experimenting with the lower field of MRI. There are some people believe in a very in a 7 Tesla MRI. So there are still, we are not certain which way will go, but remember one thing, that healthcare in the future has to be much more efficient and much more economical. And this is where I think there is definitely a place for the low field MRI, for example. Photon CT, I think 10 years from now, probably we'll all have photon CT as we slowly replace the technology. But rather than saying, talking about the equipment and the machines, it's talking about our integrated approach to interpretation. There cannot be a separate report for CT, separate report for MRI, and a separate report for PET-CT. We are uniquely qualified and positioned to integrate the findings of those reports and give a clinically relevant impression. And that is so that integration, will AI help us there? Yes, absolutely. But at the end, we should give the clinical impact, clinically impactful report.
Tell us more about precision imaging and image-guided intervention, especially in the realm of radiotheranostics.
Yes. So one very important and big part of radiology, and I'm smiling because I absolutely love seeing the progress in interventional radiology, where in the 90s it was all vascular and turf battle. And then the big next was really interventional oncology, tumor ablations, and all other tricks that they are now doing. It's actually spectacular. Now they're introducing robotics. They are flourishing. And we have to make sure to do everything possible that they remain a part of radiology. They don't wander into surgery, or some people even say radiation oncology. Radiology is their home, and I do hope they stay with us. And we need to support them because it's a very important part of radiology. Radiology in the future will have a great value when it offers diagnostics and therapy. And this is why IR is so dear and so important to us. Another one, of course, is radiotheranostics. We worked very hard the last 20 years on molecular imaging, and then the last 5 years, it was really a burst of radiotheranostics. It's so wonderful to be able to treat what you see. And people sometimes do not understand with radiotheranostics, as we administer the treatment, it goes to the target, but because it has radiation, it stays there. It's a focal radiation IV administered. And the field is expanding, it's flourishing, and we need to have strong subspecialty within nuclear medicine that really wants to treat patients. We treated thyroid cancer since 1946. It is now just that we are expanding, and we desperately need more nuclear medicine physicians that are going to subspecialize in therapy and radiotheranostics.
This brings us back to what we were talking about in the beginning, which is radiologists being victims of their own success.
Yes, absolutely, yes.
Well, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
You are very, very welcome. And hope you like the article. Thank you.
I do. I really enjoy it. You can read the entire article in the January 2023 edition of the Radiology Journal. Thank you for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Dr. Vrisak, for reminding us our rich history as innovators in medicine and how we will continue to innovate and evolve to provide patient-centered, high-value care. Next week, we'll hear from Dr. James Sprink about his thoughts on what radiology will be like in 2040. This wraps up this week's podcast. Thank you for tuning in and supporting our podcast program. Please subscribe today on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, or Spotify. Come back next week for a new episode. Take care.